Our mural represents both the junior theme of Chanukah and Purim and the Sharia theme for this year of Kedushat HaZman. Chanukah and Purim have no inherent Kedushat HaZman, however we make the day Kadosh ourselves. Similarly, in both the Chanukah and Purim stories, the heroes of the Jewish nation, Esther HaMalkah and Yehuda HaMakabi, took action on behalf of the people despite any dangers and doubts there might have been. Because of their actions, Hashem finished their miracles. Our quotes demonstrate this theme perfectly. Umino tar kankanim nasa nes lashoshanim. Because Yehuda decided to light even though he knew there was only enough oil for one day, Hashem gave us a miracle. Both quotes include the word Shoshana, meaning rose, which represents Bnei Israel, as Shlomo HaMelech says in Shir HaShirim, Kishoshana b'yad b'ein HaChochim. In both stories, Bnei Israel, the rose, were surrounded by thorns, which can be seen on our mural as the Persian and Greek art surrounding our heroes. Esther in particular took a huge chance as the Shoshana in the Persian palace. Because our heroes reached out and took the initiative to create their own miracles, Hashem stepped in to complete those miracles for his nation, the Shoshana b'yad HaChochim. Thank you and Shir HaShalom.
The Jewish journey through the various exiles is a notion that was built into the very fabric of the world during creation. The Midrash teaches us that when the pasuk in the beginning of Sefer Bereishis says, "Va'aretz hayta tov avohu v'choshech al p'nei tehom," tohu refers to Galus Babel, vohu refers to Galus Paras Umadai, choshech refers to Galus Yavan, and al p'nei tehom refers to Galus Edom. The Sfas Emes, Rabbi Yehuda Aryeh Leib Alter of Ger, writes that the goal of the Jewish people's journey through Galut is to show that Hashem is in the world. In fact, the very root of the word Galus comes from the idea of revealing. Rav Shlomo Volbe writes that the notion of Kedushat HaZman is that there are times where there is a palpable difference and unique ability to connect to Hashem. Purim and Chanukah are the paradigmatic holidays and time periods where we as Jews living in Galus perceived Hashem through his miracles, even amidst the physical and spiritual threats to our people. They are the archetypes for our methods of survival in the thickness of the darkness.
Our trek to and from Egypt was really the beginning and served as a model for all voyages to and from exiles, which, according to the Ramban, is why Sefer Shemos is called Sefer Galus Ugeula. Chanukah and Purim, on the other hand, represent the transitions till the later period in Jewish history involving the Batei Mikdash and the rabbinic period of Judaism. Please follow us as we take you through our interpretation of an excursion through the various exiles and, God willing, our ultimate redemption.
The voyage to the third Beit HaMikdash begins with Galut Babel. Masechet Yoma teaches us that the reason for the Chorban was that the Jews were guilty of three most severe averot: murder, idolatry, and adultery. How could a nation with a Beit HaMikdash with such open miracles and Nevi'im that directly conveyed the word of God have been led astray? Yirmiyahu explains that Bnei Israel lost the land because they left the Torah. Alma avda ha'aretz.
Al ezvam et Torati. The Gemara in Nedarim qualifies this and explains that this means that they did not say Berchot HaTorah. How is it possible that Rav could have interpreted this pasuk as referring to the recitation of brachot on Torah, when the Nevi'im witnessed the people committing the most heinous of sins? The Maharal addresses all of these questions and connects the lack of Birchot HaTorah to the big three sins. He explains that one who fails to utter the brachot HaTorah does so because they miss the essence of Torah itself. They fail to realize the sanctity and unique character of Torah and reduce it to being like any other academic discipline.
Only when the Torah is perceived in such a light does it have the capacity to ennoble and enable people to live on a higher spiritual plane. It is for this reason that without the correct understanding of Torah and the ability to meaningfully connect the words of Torah to Hashem and his values, we lost our connection to Hashem. It is in this same vein that Rav Chaim of Volozhin writes that before an individual begins learning Torah, they should prepare and remind themselves that the goal of this learning is to connect to and discover God.
For the first time since the lifetime of Moshe Rabbeinu, who was the original link in the Masorah, the Torah had to leave Eretz Yisrael. From now on, the Jewish people and the Torah would have to survive in a new way, one that didn't rely on having a central gathering location, divine intervention, or or sovereignty. Before they go into Galus, though, Yirmiyahu promises that they will return in 70 years. All that the Jews have to rely on, that is directly from God, is the Zman of Geula. The rest of the hallway is about restoring our holy relationship with God and breaking down the separating wall that had grown in its place.
Judges, please follow me to the entrance of the Persian palace. Sefer Yeshayahu promises the Jews that Hashem would completely annihilate Babel because they destroyed Yerushalayim. 52 years after the Khorban, Belshazzar was conquered, signifying the end of the kingdom of Babel and the start of Galut Madai. Esther was one of the first indications that Hashem was still protecting his people, even though they didn't have the Beit HaMikdash. Please follow me to the felt and turn around to see the Persian palace. The Gemara in Megillah explains that the quote above, "Batachat hasarpad ya'aleh hadas," is Vashti, specifically because of her distant connection to the Khorban. She is the great-granddaughter of Nebuchadnezzar, who burned the Beit HaMikdash, and the Sirpad is a contraction of the words Seraph Rifidat Beit Hashem. Vashti thus was fittingly killed at Ahasuerus' feast, which showed off the kelim of the Beit HaMikdash. This feast was originally held to celebrate the fact that the Jews no longer could rebuild the Beit HaMikdash. Instead, in one of the Purim story's first cases of Vinahafochu, it led to the final thing that had to happen before it could be rebuilt.
Haggai. I think I'll go with the Esther one. Everyone seems to love her.
And the winner is Miss Columbia!
Haggai! I chose the Esther one.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, folks. The real winner is Esther!
Judges, will you please make your way towards the tile and join the audience of our talk show? Vanochi haster astir panai. I will hide my face. Hashem's presence will not be known openly to the world, so our role is to make it known. Despite the hidden nature of Hashem's revelation to the people, they were able to find, see, and spread the message of Hashem. The Sfat Emet writes that by surviving each one of the four Galiot, we are able to restore and reveal another aspect of Hashem in the world. While typically, for practical concerns associated with raising a family, women are not expected to be able to commit to all time bound ritual practices. When it comes to Megillah, Arba Kosot, and Hanukkah candles, they're expected to perform them nonetheless for the sake of publicizing the miracle. Because women were not only involved in being saved from potential danger, but were essential to inspiring the salvation, they too are expected to do everything possible, including atypical monetary sacrifice, to spread the message and involvement of Hashem to anyone possible.
Congrats on your win.
Thank you so much.
So, Esther, tell me about your experience in the palace.
Well, it was very nice, but the food situation was a little complicated. The other contestants had some things to say about my lack of makeup and my short beauty routine, so I guess you can say I was the underdog in this competition.
One of the big questions circulating the media is your origin and religion. One belief is that you're Jewish and your God intervened in making you queen. Comments?
Jewish? No way. That's funny.
Well, you certainly seem nicer than the other queen, Vashti, and we're glad that you're here to contribute to our kingdom.
Of course. Thanks.
Judges, if you could please make your way back this way. As we said earlier, Hashem wove the concept of galut into the very fabric of the world and had a plan for saving us and leading us through the difficult times even before they existed. Hekdim Rufu'ah L'Malka. In the days of Purim, we see this pattern repeated. Esther was in place as queen before Haman's plot reached Ahasuerus. Mordechai was conveniently written into the king's record as a savior before he needed to unseat Haman from his power.
Yes, but Moshe died in that month.
Haman was very happy, and the Jews were in despair. They did not believe that they would be saved. What Haman didn't realize was that Moshe was also born in Adar. Already, Haman's plan was being flipped.
What should be rewarded to someone who honors the king?
He should be dressed in the king's garments, riding the king's horse throughout the city.
So do that to Mordechai.
What?
We see in this an example of Vinahafocho. Haman imagines a future of dominance over Mordechai and the Jews, but Hashem had planted the seeds for the switch, and Haman is forced to honor him.
There is a man trying to kill me and my people.
Who is this man?
It's Haman.
To the gallows.
The Jews fought and defeated their enemies across the kingdom and were overjoyed.
Yay!
Afterwards, Mordechai became advisor to the king, completing his flip with Haman. Mordechai sent out a letter to all the Jews telling them to make a holiday. The Megillah says that the Jews kimu v'kiblu. While originally the people accepted the Torah out of fear of death, here the people accepted the Torah out of love, passion, and desire. The Gemara and Megillah similarly explains that the word Ora in Lehudim Haita Ora Vasimcha refers to the Torah. The Jews, through exile, definitely stood out as the Or LaGoyim. They recognized their unique and significant role more now that they had in almost a millennium of prophecy and open miracles, and after Purim saw how much they needed the Torah more than ever and accepted it with even with its stringencies. This marked the real beginning of Torah Shebaal Peh and Mitzvot Derabanan.
The first big mitzvot derabanan that were ever established were the mitzvot of Purim. Mordechai and Esther were endowed with Ruach HaKodesh and knew that the Torah and Galus needed a strong unifying force since they didn't have a central location like the Beit HaMikdash. They established four mitzvot. The Megillah readings halachot, as spelled out in the beginning of Masechet Megillot, are specifically tailored to be able to have the Megillah read in greater crowds. Matanot La'avyonim, the mitzvah to have a feast, and Mishloach Manot are clearly direct attempts to bring the Jewish people closer together.
Judges, please come this way and enter in our fun house for the Nevi'im of Shivat Zion. Even though the return of Torah should have been the path to tapping into Hashem and his will, the Jews still felt a serious lacking without a rebuilt Beit HaMikdash. Even before the Purim story, there was a movement to rebuild. However, this movement only came to fruition after the people became unified. The 70 years of exile foretold by Yirmiyahu were over, but the Jews were conditioned to be looking for the signs of Hashem in the miraculous, and as a result, insisted that the time of return had not arrived. Hashem, the constant protector of Jews and Galus, sends Nevi'im in order to make messages of the world even more abundantly clear to his people. Chagai Hanavi arrives on the scene bearing the first Nevuah in decades and insists that it is the time to build the Beit HaMikdash. The Jews say to Chagai that they can't build yet because they are not yet autonomous. Lo eit bo, eit Beit Hashem lehibano. Chagai responds, the right time for building of a house of Kedusha does not need to wait if they initiate. Making ourselves worthy of Hashem's presence is not dependent on the time of year but on the quality of our actions.
This is Jeopardy. All the way from Eretz Yisrael, Shmuley the Kohen, and from Teaneck, New Jersey, Chaya Larson. Shmuley, you're in command of the board.
10 words for 400, please.
This is the status of a food that touches a dead animal.
What is tumah?
Correct. If you know the answer to this question, why aren't you properly serving Hashem in the Beit HaMikdash?
Chagai teaches the Kohanim that even though they, that even though they accepted the Torah properly after the Purim story, they aren't properly applying it. The first Beis HaMikdash was destroyed because of sins due to the lack of appreciation for Torah. Therefore, the road ahead would be forged with the reevaluation of sanctity and application. Haggai's second Nevuah promised to destroy the other nations. Amala comes to Zechariah and shows him the menorah. The angel explains that it is a call to rebuild the Beit HaMikdash with the menorah. Lo b'chayil v'lo b'koach ki'im beruchi. As opposed to the grandeur that accompanied Yetziat Mitzrayim, this entrance to the land would instead be defined by the effort the Jews themselves put in. The era of Nevuah is coming to an end, and the sole way to tap into the Ratzon HaShem will be through the Torah and those that learn and use it. The Nevuah is received well by the people, and the Beit HaMikdash is built, starting on Chaf Hei Kislev, which would eventually become the Zman of Chanukah.
Okay, judges, please come into the cave. The end of Galus Madai came at the hands of Alexander the Great, whose kingdom was inherited in part by the Syrian Greeks about 200 years later, beginning Galus Yavan. The Greeks attempted to ruin the purity of Bnei Israel's religious connection to God and impose their own beliefs.
Hear ye, hear ye. The following are hereby outlawed by order of the king. There shall be no circumcision. There shall be no Shabbos. There shall be no sanctification of the month, and there shall be no Torah.
Although the Syrian Greeks tried to destroy our connection to the mitzvot that made the Jewish people unique and distinguished them with their peers, the Jews defiantly learned Torah secretly in caves. Rabbi Akiva would, 100 years in the future, explain this dangerous act from the Pasuk, Ki hu chayecha ve'orech yamecha, that we cannot live without Torah no matter the stakes.
Rabbi, how are we supposed to connect to Hashem?
We live in a time without Nevi'im to turn to for direction and guidance in connecting with Hashem. In their place, the Kohanim have assumed the mantle of leadership and are directing us in ascending further up the ladder towards Hashem.
While it would seem, based on our modern-day observance, that the main focus of the hands of God was with regard to the miracle of the oil, in fact, the Maharal writes that the purpose of the miracle of the oil was to redirect our attention to the true hand of Hashem in the war. This picture depicts every person in our grade, but hidden is a picture of the Greeks and Jews fighting in the war. Yad Hashem is always there, even if you may not see it. Sometimes, in order to see Hashem's presence, you must take a step back and view the whole picture. So here on the iPad is a picture of when you take a step back of what it looks like. And when you look closely, it's everyone in our grade.
Now that I was involved in the war, the mitzvot of Chanukah will also include women. Sha'af hein hayu be'oto hani.
Go Jews!
Giburim b'yad chalashim, the rabbim b'yad me'atim. After the Chashmonaim miraculously conquered the Beit HaMikdash, they established themselves as the royal family. These kings were the first Jewish kings since Sidkiyahu, who ruled before the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash almost 300 years earlier. The Jewish people were, at this point, the closest to their status during first Beit HaMikdash since its destruction. They have a Beit HaMikdash built through the divine messages of the Nevi'im, and now they have sovereignty. These two things allow us to say Hallel. Two reasons the Gemara gives for not saying Hallel on Purim are that they were in servitude to a foreign king in addition to Hashem, and they were not in Eretz Yisrael. The Gemara teaches that the reading of the Megillah commemorates the Nes in place of Hallel. Whereas big miracles constitute a recitation of Hallel, Purim's miracles that are hidden are captured best by Megillah Esther.
This short time period was defined by a deep penetrating light and deep galus defined by dark. God answered their yearning for a connection by moving toward the people and making a miracle happen when the Chashmonaim entered the defiled Beit HaMikdash.
Welcome to the Beit HaMikdash Oil Factory. You all know about the war and the miracles that occurred, but we are taking you behind the scenes of the oil miracle. The only oil that was halakhically fit to be lit lasted for not one, but 8 days, which was enough time to get to our factory here in Tokawa and back with a new supply of tar oil. The Nace showed the Jews 2,000 years ago that even with the gigantic movement towards Greek culture surrounding and penetrating the Jewish thought throughout the Bayesheni, they had to remember that they were supposed to remain a distinct Orlegoyim, even though it was Yavon's goal to cause us to forget the Torah, Lashkichlechem Toratecha, and cause much Choshech in our lives. Hashem allowed the light of the menorah to illuminate the darkness and impress the message of Torah on the world. Just as in the case of Purim, there was true Or for the Yehudim of the time.
It is because of this that in both times of Chanukah and Purim, Chazal stressed the need for us to recite Al Anisim and express our extreme gratitude and thanks for Hashem's hand in our lives. As a way of expressing this thanks, we have been encouraged to perform all the mitzvot surrounding these holidays in the most public and expressing way possible. We like to celebrate the mitzvah by giving out donuts made with the holiest oil in the world.
Get it? Holiest? Because donuts have holes?
It is this mission to fill the world with the light of Torah and we grow our olives in the same groves since the time of our return to Israel. Here in the beautiful countryside, we watch over all of them to make sure they are of the highest quality. They are carefully crushed in our old-fashioned press into the holy oil uses into the Beit HaMikdash itself.
It is this mission to fill the world with the light of the Torah and mitzvot that all Jewish mothers pray for their children each Friday night while lighting the Shabbos candles. Umarim et ha'olam b'Torah u'b'masim tovim.
The Beit HaMikdash is burning down. The Romans are destroying the factory. They're even taking the donuts.
Rabbi Akiva warned that the most important part of the Torah was v'ahavta l'rayecha kamocha, loving others like you love yourself. The Jews didn't listen to him, and the Beit HaMikdash, never once reaching the high level of the first one, was destroyed by the rising Roman Empire because of Sinat Chinam. This marks the beginning of Galus Edom, the last of the four Galiot.
Galus Edom, as predicted, became the worst ever, with the Jewish nation rejecting the Torah in mass groups and persecution from other faiths. This Chorban, for almost two millennia, seemed to be impossible to overcome. That was until Britain allowed the UN to vote on a Jewish state. Rav Soloveitchik pointed out that this was a modern public example of Hashem's hand knocking for his beloved nation to join him like he called for in Shir HaShirim, Kol Dodi Dofeik.
Now, Lebanon, now, Soviet Union, yes, United Kingdom, abstain, the United States, yes.
Wow, a Jewish homeland. Hashem has faithfully come to his people's aid once again. This is truly a hidden hand of Hashem. We are coming closer to true autonomy like we had in the days of Malchut Beit David.
Since then, Hashem's hand in Israel has never ceased. Israel has made incredible advances in its military, agriculture, and technology, whether it be military or medicine.
The IDF has had stunning victories throughout its short history. Starting from the War of Independence, Hashem has protected our soldiers in ways that can only be described as miraculous.
Not only is Hashem's hand seen in military victories, but also in the incredible creations of drip irrigation, allowing produce to be grown in the desert, fulfilling the words of Yeshayahu. Yisasum midbar v'tzia v'tagel arava v'tifrach k'gavat zelat paroach tifrach v'tagel af gilat v'ranen.
Drip irrigation is one of the miraculous innovations created in the land of Israel. Great strides have been made in the medical and defense fields, specifically the PILCAM and the Iron Dome Missile Defense System. These creations have radically changed the lives of Israelis around the country and has allowed them to lead longer, safer lives.
All these miracles are straight from Hashem, showing us that Galus Edom is
nearing its end. The minhag of many, including our school, is to say Hallel on Yom HaAtzmaut on Heyar. This day, like dates for Purim and Chanukah, originally had no historical significance. Any time has the capacity to become a vessel capable of receiving Hashem's holy presence.
The Gemara in Tanis records the following story about Rabbi Chanina ben Dosa, who once found his daughter crying on Friday night because she had accidentally lit vinegar instead of oil for her Shabbos candles and was worried that they would go out and she would be left in the dark. Rabbi Chanina consoled her by saying that just as Hashem makes oil burn, he can make vinegar burn too. The message that we can learn from this story is that Hashem makes miracles in everything that he does. But when he does the same miracle every day, we simply call it nature. It would be just as miraculous for Hashem to let the vinegar burn as when oil burns on an average day. This could be the answer to why Chanukah is celebrated for 8 days instead of seven. The very fact that the oil burns for the first day, as it was expected to, was a miracle that we call nature. Chanukah comes to teach us that every day is full of miracles, and only if we truly open our eyes to them and recognize their source can we bring back the open miracles of the Beit HaMikdash. This is the only way that we can personally make a Zman holy like the Chachamim did by Purim and Chanukah.
The Sfas Emes writes that while in Galus, our eyes are closed, as we see from the fact that Parshas Vayechi, which takes place right before the Galus, is written closed. There is no space separating its text and the text that precedes it. On the other hand, while experiencing some form of Geula, our eyes are opened as we see that the text of the Shirat Hayam is written with wide open spaces. Our trip through the various exiles has taken us from seeing Hashem in the open miracles to seeing Hashem in some everyday activities to seeing Hashem in everything. It is for this reason that we set aside specific brachos to recite on mundane activities such as getting up each morning and opening our eyes.
מודה אני לפניך, מלך חי וקיים, שחזרת בנשמתי בחמלה רבה מונסך. ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך עולם, פוקח עברים.
Sorry, no cameras allowed.
ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך העולם, אשר יצר את האדם בחוכמה עברה, בו נקבים נקבים, חללים חללים, גלוי וידעו לפני כיסא כבדיך, שאם יפסח אחד מהם, או יסתם אחד מהם, אי אפשר להתקיים, לעמוד לפניך, ברוך אתה השם, רופאיך בשר ומפליא לעשות.
Just like going to the bathroom is an everyday miracle, so too is going outside and witnessing miracles such like, oh, before we go outside, let's put on some tzitzis.
ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך העולם, מלביש ערומים.
Now we can enjoy the outside world just like the wonderful winter wonderland that God has created.
It's beautiful. מרבו מעשיך, השם, כולם בחוכמה עשית, מלך כארץ הנניך.
Witnessing natural occurrences such as lightning and thunder.
ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך העולם, עושה מעשה בראשית. ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך העולם, שכוחו וגבורתו מלא העולם.
And now, just like we saw in Frisch at the beginning of Sharia, we have a massive, beautiful rainbow which God has granted us.
ברוך אתה השם, אלוקינו מלך העולם, זוכר הברית ונאמן בבריתו וקיים במאמרו. מרא בו מעשיך.
You are about to walk through model gates of the third Beit HaMikdash. Before entering, take a second to see the beauty in these solid gold gates. Unfortunately, since this is only a replica, the nais of everyone fitting is not applicable here, so we apologize in advance for any discomfort. This section will show what we need to do in order to merit the coming of Mashiach and the building of the third Beit HaMikdash. Judges, if you will please follow me into our model Beit HaMikdash. It has been quite a journey through the exiles. In Bamidbar, Perek Lamed Gimel, Pasuk Aleph, the Torah tells us after listing the travels of Bnei Israel in the wilderness, Eile Mas'ei Bnei Yisrael. These are the journeys of the children of Israel. This Pasuk is also an acronym for the four exiles, as you can see here, Edom, Madai, Bavel, and Yavan. These four exiles, represented by the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the horned beast, symbolize the struggles and difficulties with connecting and discovering Hashem throughout our history. They represent our checkered past, struggling with some of the worst avirot imaginable, murder, idolatry, adultery, and senseless hatred. Our trek through the exile and our redemption from it represents a gradual journey of redeeming ourselves from these distant actions and working hard to bring ourselves closer to Hashem. Each step along the way has freed us from the shackles of distance and brought us all the more close to seeing Hashem in the world. That is why these four exiles correspond with the Arba Lashonot Geulah, as at each point we have been redeemed a little bit more. The four steps of Geulah are portrayed here in the four Lishkaot, chambers, in the future Beit HaMikdash. These four Lishkaot are meant to serve as a manifestation of Frisch's four core values, as Frisch is our Mikdash Me'at in which we strive to find Hashem in all of our ways, as the school's motto is Bechol Derachecha Dayehu. Galut Bavel, in this corner, was characterized by Avodah Zarah. In the time of Mashiach and the third Beit HaMikdash, we will correct that by growing religiously. The culture of Frisch is one that nurtures its students with Torah and love of Judaism. Galut Paras U'Madai, in this corner, was a result of murder, cutting off one's potential. Therefore, we shall change that with intellectual curiosity. When we search and learn in secular studies, we will reach our potential and find many ways to connect to each other and God.
Galut Yavan, in this corner, came about through adultery, unrestrained emotions. In order to fix this, we channel our emotions and talents into positive actions. Through Sharia, potential is unleashed and passion shines. One look at these hallways and all other presentations, you will see this tonight, and you will understand that passion is involved in creating such masterpieces. We take the strengths and talents we have and focus them on involving ourselves in the week's worth. For that opportunity and potential, we must say thank you to everyone who makes this happen. In this corner, we have Galut Edom, which we are still unfortunately in today, was caused by Sinat Chinam, senseless hatred. In order to truly merit the coming of Mashiach, we must flip that into Avat Chinam. Avat Chinam comes through every small act of kindness. Whether it is a major deed or not, each act counts. Frisch gives us the opportunity to do acts of kindness through various chesed activities, but we are not limited to only these. Any nice deed, any compliment is a kindness. Only when we accomplish all of the core four will we be fortunate to achieve the plus one, meaningful relationships. Through each of these, we will form relationships with each other and ultimately with God. The Chavos HaTalmidim writes that to the extent that we draw ourselves close together, Hashem draws himself closer to us and vice versa. We saw this very clearly when the Jews learned in the caves and Hashem responded with the miracle of the oil, and when the Jews reaccepted the Torah of Purim and Hashem returned them to the Beit HaMikdash. Therefore, not only does our coming together yield a greater ability to have Yirat Shamayim, thus yielding more Kedusha and less dividers, but it simply grows the relationship between Hashem and the Jewish people. As we enter into the time of Mashiach, which the Midrash says corresponds to the fifth term in the Pasuk of Sefer Bereishit that we spoke about in the beginning, Ruach Elokim Merachepet al Pnei HaMayim, we shall notice that these violations of the past have been corrected and redeemed. The tendency for murder has been converted into allowing individuals to grow and develop. The tendency to commit idolatry has been converted into a deep relationship with Hashem. The tendency to commit adultery has been converted into channeling our energies in appropriate ways. And finally, the tendency to hate others has been converted into society full of chesed and kindness. Not only do these achievements represent the Rambam's goal of all Torah, as he writes at the end of Laws of Chanukah and Purim, that you will see on that wall over there, Gadol HaShalom Shekol HaTorah Nitzna La'asot Shalom Ba'olam. The entirety of Torah was given to create peace and harmony in the world, but they also represent the goals of our daily life here in Frisch. All of the core four are only possible when joined by a fifth principle of meaningful relationships, our personal fifth expression of redemption, Vehiveti. We hope that our journey through our national and personal exiles and redemptions is able to bring forth the fifth stage of creation, the arrival of Mashiach, a complete nullification of evil, being able to witness God completely and recognize him. Then can we truly return and cling to him.
June what?
June yes!
June what?
June yes! June.